Yeah, okay, so welcome back everyone. So today it's our first speaker for the academic year, and that will be Frédéric Barbarès from Thales in France. And he'll be talking about Suryo symplectic foliation, structure of dynamical systems and machine learning on the groups. Yeah, thank you again. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for the organizer of this seminar on machine learning on dynamical system. So my talk will be dedicated some to tools that has been developed by Jean-Marie Suryo, which is a French mathematician and physicist, has developed some tools in the framework of mechanics. But he has developed some tools also for statistical mechanics that we are using for developing machine learning on Lie groups. So I will give some introduction to Jean-Marie Suryo and also Jean-Louis Cozul, which is a French mathematicians with some connection with the work of Jean-Marie Suryo. We will introduce what is called a Suryo-Lie group thermodynamic. It is a symplectic model of statistical mechanics that will be very useful for machine learning on Lie group. And this tool enables us to introduce a new definition of entropy that is defined as a invariant Casimir function in coadjuvant representation. So I will explain hereafter what does it mean, but it is a new, no longer an axiomatic definition of entropy, but a geometric characterization of entropy. And these geometric structures open the work to the analysis of metriplectic flow, which are used especially for dissipative heat equation. And this metriplectic model has been confirmed recently by Baptiste Coquinot at École Normale Supérieure, because the metriplectic model has been introduced without very strong foundation, but Baptiste Coquinot has made some connection with classical non-equilibrium thermodynamic on especially Onzinger relation. And I will introduce other structure, geometric structure, which are transverse structures that describe the dissipative heat equation. And to conclude, I will introduce how to compute statistical densities for Lie group. And especially, we will see that it could be used also for computing probability of density for symmetric positive definite matrices. So this is just some highlights of my abstract of my talk. So I put in red the important points. So the important point that it is a new symplectic model of information geometry, which is based on Jean-Marie Suryo's Lie group thermodynamic. So it is deduced from his book Structure of Dynamical System. And the entropy acquire a new definition as a Casimir function. There is a link also with information geometry, because we can define what we call in information geometry Fisher metric, but for Lie group. And we introduce a Gibbs density, which has a property to be covariant under the action of the Lie group. And these structures that appears geometric structures is in fact linked to foliation in geometry. So especially this is a foliation of the coadjuvant orbit, which are the level set of entropy. So it's very interesting to interpret geometrically the first and the second principle of thermodynamic. And so with this extension of this notion of entropy, we can define a density of maximum entropy, which are give the play the role of Gaussian distribution, and we will illustrate for the Gaussian distribution computation for the space of symmetric positive definite matrices. Okay. Classically, thermodynamics has been introduced since the work of Sadi Carnot with a very analytical equation, but it's very difficult to try to understand the foundation of thermodynamics because, in fact, it's not completely explained what are the foundation and the structure of this science. So what we have done for developing a machine learning on Lie group, so it's try to make new foundation of this model. So it is based on structures, so geometric structure, Lie group structures, but we will see that it is also linked to Poisson and symplectic structures, and also linked with information geometry, so information structures. We will make a connection with some invariants. So most important is the Kossuth-Suriot-Fischer metric, which is a metric introduced in information geometry to define some distance between density of probability in the space of parameters. We'll introduce the Suriot-Gibbs density, which is a density which is covariant under the action of the group. And another tool, which is called Suriot moment map. So a moment map is in fact a geometrization of Noether theorem. So Noether theorem is a pure algebraic theorem that says that if you have some symmetries, you have some invariant. And the Suriot moment map is a geometrization of the Noether theorem. It is also invariants are also linked to the theory of representation theory of Lie group on coadjoint orbit. There is also some close link with calculus of variation. We will see that we will introduce another Poincaré equation and make reference to Suriot Maxwell principle. On about entropy, we will introduce a new definition of entropy as a geometric structure, as an invariant Casimir function in coadjoint representation, and also entropy general definition as a Legendre transform of log of Laplace transform, which we given by the structure of information geometry. And from this generalization of definition of entropy, we could introduce maximum entropy probability density. And one main property of using Lie group is some coordinate-free principle properties. And we'll introduce coordinate-free flow, for example, like natural gradient in information geometry or natural Langevin dynamics, and also some links with geometric and symplectic integrators. So the important theory is, has been called by Suriot Lie group thermodynamics. So you should be familiar with the theory of heat of Fourier, the analytical theory of heat, or the mechanical theory of heat of Clausius, or the mathematical theory of heat of Poisson. And the objective of Suriot was to develop a geometric theory of heat in his book, Structure of Dynamical System. And more specifically, it is related to a symplectic theory of heat. So if you are interested, I have published recently in the Handbook of Statistics number 46, which is dedicated to geometry and statistics, a paper on this topic with many details in the demonstration, which is called a symplectic theory of heat on information geometry. And also has a Suriot has only published in French his work. We have organized at École de physique des Houches in France in 2020 a seminar on geometric structure of statistical physics, information geometry and learning. And I have translated in the proceedings three papers of Suriot where he has introduced this model. And also a world scientific has recently published a very big book on frontiers in entropy across the discipline. And I have also two papers, one on the symplectic model of Suryo and the other one on the Lie group thermodynamic. And if you are interested, we have just been involved in a European COST network that will be funded by the European Commission, which is called CALISTA for Carton Geometry, Lie Integrable System, Quantum Group Theories and Application, where one work package is dedicated to Lie group thermodynamic. And also another funded by the European Commission is the Marie Curie Action Caligola, where you have also work package which is dedicated to the geometry of deep learning on making reference to information geometry and Lie group thermodynamic. I try to motivate also a young researcher in Europe to work on the model of Suryo, which is not so so difficult to address. And also recently you have a master report by a student from Liège University, which is from Guillaume Neutiens, but it is in French, so it's Gibbs states of Hamiltonian action, which are developing the Suryo Lie group thermodynamic. And also I have invited at a conference I have organized at Institut Henri Poincaré, Andrew Beckett from Maxwell Institute from University of Edinburgh, which has given a talk on homogeneous symplectic space and central extension that I will explain thereafter, but which is the affine model of Suryo. So also some advertisement. I am organizing a conference since 2013, which is called GSI, Geometric Science of Information, that we have organized at École des Mines de Paris and École Polytechnique, but also at ENAC in Toulouse and at Sorbonne University. And the next edition will be at the end of August 2023 at Saint-Malo. So I invite you to attend and to submit some papers. So the deadline is the 20th of February, and it will be take place at French Brittany in Saint-Malo. So you have already a website. So it's if you put GSI 23, you will find this website. Okay, so what Lie algebra is very important in machine learning and in computation, because if we look at the history of algebra on computing, so first computers were based on Boole algebra, and for the time being we are at the state of linear algebra, which is the success of linear algebra with very high powerful computer like Google TPU, but which are only using linear algebra tools. And so what is interesting is to look at Lie algebra, which is other algebra for computation with other tools like symplectic integrators, coadjoint orbit, moment map. On some tools have started to be developed for machine learning. I will give you some example in the hereafter. And also we could look at Lie superalgebra, which has been also studied for example by Berezin in Russia. So Lie algebra is an important tool for computation. And if you are interested, so in France we have launched an action, so especially Xavier Pennec and his PhD and postdoc students, but some PhD students of Thales have contributed to this library, which is called GeomStat. So it is a Python library for Lie group machine learning and also machine learning on differential manifold, which is available on a GitHub, and you have also some paper describing these libraries. So before describing the tools, technical tools for Lie Group machine learning, I would like to give you some motivation. So for the time being, we are talking a lot about cognitive AI mainly for decision or for classification. But in the human mind, we can make reference also to motion intelligence. So before recognizing an object in the world, the human brain try to learn first to learn the space and to capture the invariants given by the Lie group structures and moving it. And also they use that for recognizing object in space. So to recognize that an object is an independent object, the brain has to mimic some Lie algebra structures on action to understand that an object is independent and has some symmetries and some invariants. So it's important to consider these two kinds of AI. So AI for decision and AI for motion. So I skip that, but it's also in military domain, it's theory of decision and theory of action. So if we look at Lie group tools for motion intelligence, for example, for guidance, navigation and control, and for robotic, for motion planning and swarming, you have some mature tools for Lie group processing or Lie group machine learning. But for smart sensor and decision aid, it's less mature and it's more emerging, and especially Lie group machine learning. So if we see a look at machine deep learning algorithm on image dataset, I think we have reached an asymptotic bound of performances, and especially limited more by the bias and error of human labelization. On machine deep learning should be extended to a new, more structured data coding space because it opens new application. So it's important to extend machine learning for graph, especially the link with Lie group is that you have some technique of studying graph and to embed this graph in hyperbolic geometry in Poincaré unit disk. And then on this Poincaré unit disk, you have a Lie group acting on the Poincaré unit disk that could be used for making machine learning on graph. On Lie group, the Lie group will appear in two different contexts. You could have an homogeneous space, so your data are on live on a homogeneous space where a Lie group act, or your data are directly some element of Lie group as in robotic. And also gradient flow for machine or deep learning could be improved by more efficient integrators like symplectic integrators or information geometry natural gradient, and I will explain that hereafter. So what is why Lie group is natural is Lie group is very simple when we master the Lie algebra of this theory. And Lie group use all symmetries of your problem, so it's important because you capture symmetry, so you can reduce the space of the size of the space of parameters. Lie group is coordinate free, so it's also important in some cases of application. And Lie group preserve invariance with respect to all transformation. So if we look at history of machine learning during the 90s, in the framework of information geometry has been introduced a natural gradient that will give you some details in after, which has a property that the gradient is invariant with respect to the parametrization. But the most difficulty was to extend this natural gradient for deep learning. And so the deep learning arrived, and some people have developed a deep natural gradient, especially at LREORC laboratory in Paris-Saclay campus, and especially Yann Olivier and Gaëtan Marceau Caron. I will explain after. And they have also introduced the natural Langevin dynamic, mixing the natural gradient and also a stochastic part given by Langevin dynamics. So you have some extension on deep learning on graph, and also deep learning on Lie groups. So, you have some work by ETH Zurich, for example, or KU Leuven, but other laboratories. And so you have now Lie group machine learning, which are using more structure of the Lie group. And what I will present is more linked to another extension that is machine learning on a symplectic manifold. So I will not give reference to other. So the use of Lie group in machine learning is also used for what we call geometric deep learning for Lie group equivariant convolutional network. But I will not make references to that in my talk today, because it is another branch of machine learning using Lie group structures. So I will focus more on the, what I call Lie group machine learning, which is how to extend machine learning tools on Lie group on homogeneous manifold. So I have organized a special issue of Entropy 2 years ago on Lie group machine learning and Lie group structure preserving integrator. De Gruyter also has published a book which is called Lie group machine learning. So where we find this kind of application, it's mainly in you can find in robotics. So why it's natural in robotics? Because the human brain has also a mimic the Lie group structure. For example, here it is illustrated the visuovestibular brain system. And in fact, the vestibular system is made of three rings with liquid, and these three rings are used to measure the algebra of the homogeneous Galileo group, which is given by rotation and translation. So rotation are given by the vestibular system, and translation by what we call otolith in your inner ears. So some people have developed some like VNet, some LSTM neural network working on SS3 Lie group. So it is used also in robotics for control and also based on model-based reinforcement learning using Lie group structures. It is used also for articulated movement or posture learning, where you can code an articulated movement by SO3 or SO3. So you have a time series describing the articulated movement. So all articulation and movement of the articulation are described by an element of SO3 or SO3 Lie group. And then you have a time series of a vector with each component is an element of a Lie group. So other paper, and so you have many publications on this topic, like this one on past signature on Lie group. And also it has been, it is useful also for data in a measured space. So especially one very useful space is Poincaré hyperbolic space. And it is interesting, especially for natural language processing. So where people have observed that it is very interesting to embed a graph in a hyperbolic space, like in a Poincaré unit disk, because you can preserve some distance between point in your graph. So you can reduce the dimensionality because you have a graph of very high dimension that you can embed in the Poincaré unit disk. Another and last example of motivation for machine learning only group, for example, is to code some, when you have a trajectory like this trajectory of a drone, you can code it as a time series of rotation and translation of the Fresnes-Serret frame. And so the main interest is that you can describe the trajectory without coordinate, but only as a local rotation and translation of the local Fresnes-Serret frame. I skip that. Okay. So Ligroup machine learning is very useful in many contexts. So I will talk about Jean-Marie Souriot on also by the to Jean-Louis Cozoul. So they were both graduated from École Normale Supérieure in Paris. So Jean-Marie Souriot is mainly a physicist and Jean-Louis Cozoul a mathematician. But we will see that there is some connection between their two works. So they were very soon integrated in the geometric community during this period. So here is a very famous conference in Strasbourg on differential geometry with the main keynote speaker during this period, like Ehrlichman, Lichnerowitz, Paulette Liberman, but you have also Laurent Schwartz, Georges de Rame, Guggenheimer, you have also Jean-Louis Cozoul, André Weil, René Thom, Jean Milner, Marcel Berger, which are very well-known geometer. And so Cozoul and Soyo were integrated in this community. They were also for the colloquium dedicated to Élie Cartan in 1984. They were also a keynote speaker, so Jean-Louis Cozoul and Jean-Marie Souriot. And recently, we have organized a meeting in Paris at Institut Henri Poincaré and at Université Paris Cité, dedicated to the 50th birthday of Souriot book, Structure des systèmes dynamiques. And you can find on YouTube a testimony of Jean-Pierre Bourguignon on this book. Jean-Pierre Bourguignon was previously director of Institut des études scientifiques, IHES, and also director of the European ERC. And he explains that when he was a young student at École Polytechnique, he has discovered and used this book. Okay, so Jean-Marie Souriot was graduated from École Normale Supérieure in Paris at what we call ENS Ulm in 1942, with the same year than Jacques Dixmier, which is also very well known in the group theory, and René de Vels. So Jean-Marie Souriot has made many works, but mainly in French. So he has worked on linear calculus. For example, he has invented an algorithm to compute the parameter of the characteristic polynomial of a matrix, which is not so well known. And, but the most main contribution of Jean-Marie Souriot was this book, Structure des systèmes dynamiques, which has been translated by Cushman, Structure of Dynamical System, a Symplectic View of Physics. So the main contribution is to have introduced symplectic geometry in mechanics. And so he has also invented the moment map, which is a geometrization of Noether theorem. And he has applied symplectic geometry to mechanics. And especially, I have read this book because of this remark. The total mass of an isolated dynamic system is a class of cohomology of the default of equivariance of the moment map. So it could seems very obscure, but in fact, it's the idea is that in a classical mechanic, you have a Lie group, which is called the Galileo group for rotation, boost in speed, and translation in space, and translation in time. And this Lie group has what we call a default of cohomology. The action of the group on the coadjoint orbit is not equivariant, and there is an additional term which is linked to an invariant, which is the total mass of the system. So it gives a geometric definition to the mass in classical mechanics. And in relativity, you have another group, which is a Poincaré group, and this the Poincaré group has no has not this default of cohomology, and so the mass don't play the same role in the two theory. But what is important is a chapter which has not been read during this period, which is the chapter 4, which was dedicated to statistical mechanics on what Sourio calls the Lie group thermodynamics. So during this period, they have read this book mainly physicists and people working on mechanics, but not people working on statistical mechanics. And so they didn't read this this book. So the book is very difficult to read. So we have Géry de Saxe and Charles-Michel Marle have made for the École des Houches seminar. They have published a summary of this book with a modern notation to give how the main ideas in this book. So it is explained in his book, but also in a paper published in 1974, which is called Statistical Mechanics, Lie groups and cohomology. And if we could read the abstract, the classical notion of Gibbs canonical ensemble is extended to the case of a symplectic manifold on which a Lie group has a symplectic action. The rigorous definition given here makes it possible to extend the center number of classical thermodynamic properties. For instance, temperature is here an element of the Lie algebra of the group, and heat an element of its dual, and also notably inequalities of convexity. In the case of non-commutative group, particular properties appear. The symmetry is spontaneously broken, and certain relations of cohomological type are verified in the Lie algebra of the group. And various applications are considered, rotating bodies, covariant, or relativistic statistical mechanics. So I have made a translation of this paper, which was published by CNRS in French in 1974. And so you can find this publication in the proceeding of the École des Houches seminar. So what is the main idea in the model of Sourio? He proves, in fact, that the temperature, or the Planck temperature that is used in classical thermodynamics, is an element of Lie algebra of a dynamical group. So it's not so obvious to understand this approach at the beginning. We will see that it is very natural. And it gives also a general definition of entropy. So the entropy is a Legendre transform of minus logarithm of Laplace transform. So it's very useful because we will be able to extend what is the notion of entropy, especially for Lie group. And also, it has introduced a metric, Riemannian metric, but that we have discovered to be related to what we call the Fisher metric in information geometry. And Sourio has interpreted this metric as a geometric calorific capacity. Okay, so I will not detail, but we could extend to higher order Lie group thermodynamic, but I will not have time to explain. So the main idea of Sourio was he has developed a formalism which is fully covariant. So especially look for covariance of Gibbs density with respect to the dynamic group acting on the system. So you can find other papers on this topic, especially Charles-Michel Marle, which is an expert of symplectic and Poisson geometry. So on archive, you can find this paper on Gibbs states of mechanical systems with symmetries, which is also a very good entry point to understand this model with modern notation. On Jean-Louis Cozul, why there is a link with Jean-Louis Cozzu's work, the relation that, in fact, Jean-Louis Cozzul has studied what we call homogeneous symmetric bounded domain. It was a topic initiated by Elie Cartan. And in information geometry for exponential families, the parameters live in this kind of space. So it's why the structures, the geometric structures that we find in information geometry are linked to the geometric structure that has been developed by Jean-Louis Cozzul. So it's the same problem. Cozzul has only published in French, so you have a selected paper of Jean-Louis Cozzul, but they are all in French. So we have the action to translate this paper in English, but we didn't yet succeed to achieve this translation. And we have also discovered some lectures given by Jean-Louis Cozzul in Sao Paulo, and especially one lecture on symmetric homogeneous space, where he gives main structures that are needed for our application. So if you are not familiar with Jean-Louis Cozzul, he was graduated from École Normale Supérieure and he was a member of the Bourbaki group. He was a PhD student of Henri Cartan, but he has worked mainly on the work of Elie Cartan. And he was a professor at Strasbourg University and then at Grenoble University. And he has attended the conference that we have organized in 2013 at École des Mines de Paris, especially to meet Hirohiko Shima, which has written a book, which is called Geometry of Hessian Structure, who was the first to make the relation to the work of Cozzul on the information geometry. So the main inspiration of Cozzul was Elie Cartan to work on homogeneous symmetric bounded domain. So it is a big foliation. So the main example of symmetric homogeneous bounded domain is a Poincaré unit disk or the Poincaré half plane. And then Elie Cartan has studied and classified this symmetric homogeneous bounded domain. And he has made some assumption for a space of higher dimension. But this has been studied also by Carl Ludwig Siegel in Germany and Lukeng Hua in China, and also Ernest Winberg in Russia. And so Jean-Louis Cozzul was in connection with Ernest Winberg. And, all the tools that have been developed by Cozzul are useful for information geometry. So I invite you to read the book The Geometry of Hessian Structure by Hirohiko Shima, where you have a clear view of a connection between the work of Jean-Louis Cozzul and the information geometry. And the last connection that we have found between Jean-Louis Cozzul and Jean-Marie Souriau is a lecture given by Jean-Louis Cozzul in China. But unfortunately, when I request to Professor Cozzul to give me the lecture in French, he has not preserved this initial lectures. And so we have requested Professor Cozzul to translate this book in English. And so, because it was only in Chinese, and so with Springer, we have translated this book in English. So the name is Introduction to Symplectic Geometry. And then you in chapter 4 and 5, you have the theory of Souriau, but with modern notation. So I have written also some paper on Jean-Louis Cozzul and the connection with information geometry, like this paper Jean-Louis Cozzul on the elementary structure of information geometry, and also invariant Cozzul form of homogeneous bounded domain on information geometry structure. And the last one is on Cozzul's lecture related to geometric analytic mechanics, Souriau Legoupe thermodynamics on information geometry in the information geometry review by Springer. Okay, so this is a long introduction, so I will start to develop more technically this theory. So to start, I have to introduce information geometry if you are not familiar. So information geometry is a theory to define a density of probability in space of parameters of this density. So you have a density of probability p theta and parameterized by the parameter theta. And it is very well known that covariance matrices of this of each statistical estimators so we with without bias is has a lower bound which is called the Kramer-Rao bound which is given by the inverse of the what we call the Fisher matrix. So the Fisher matrix is given on the right. It is given by the minus expectation of the second derivative of the log of probability. So so this this bound has been introduced by Rao in 1945 in his paper, but was in fact discovered previously by Fréchet in 1939. But in his paper, Rao, in the second part, has also introduced information geometry. So what is that he did, he defined a metric, ds square, which is given by the Culbert divergence between the density of probability p theta and density of probability parameterized by theta plus d theta. And so the Culbert divergence is given by minus log p de theta log p theta plus d theta divided by p theta. And if you make a Taylor expansion, the first term cancel and the second term is given by the Fisher matrix. So it gives a Riemannian structure in the space of parameters for density of probability. And the main property is that this density is invariant by change of parametrization. So I will illustrate you in the most simple case. If you consider a monovariate Gaussian density, the vector of parameter is the mean M on standard deviation sigma. And so the Fisher matrix is given by the inverse of the sigma square and also 2 divided by sigma square. So the matrix is diagonal, sorry, because the mean and the standard deviation are not correlated for the estimator, and their variance are given by the inverse. So we recover that the variance on the estimation of the mean is sigma square, and the variance on the estimation of sigma is sigma square divided by 2. So you have just to apply the formula of Rao. So ds square is equal to d theta transpose I theta d theta, with theta is a vector m sigma. And so you find dm square divided by sigma square plus 2 d sigma square divided by sigma square. And if you are a geometer, you will discover you observe that it is a Riemannian metric in the hyperbolic space of Poincaré, so in the upper half plane of Poincaré. So why we recover that? Because the mean is real, but sigma is positive. So the space of parameter m sigma live in the upper half plane of Poincaré. Obviously, you cannot integrate this metric. So the idea of Poincaré is to complexify the upper half plane. So you take the variable z is m divided by this term just to cancel this variable 2 which is not in the Poincaré model plus I sigma. You use this transformation which is called a Collett transformation that will transform the upper half plane of Poincaré to the unit disk of Poincaré. And after this transformation, you have this metric. So it's a more interesting metric because you have only one variable. So d omega module square divided by 1 minus omega square square. But you cannot integrate because you have a d omega module square. So the Poincaré has integrated, so I will not give the detail, but we have a formula, a close formula for distance in the Poincaré unit disk. So what does it mean? It means that when you have two Gaussian density, sigma 1, M1, sigma 1, and M2, sigma 2. M1, sigma 1 is one point in the Poincaré union disk. M2, sigma 2 is another point on the distance in the sense of information geometry is a geodesic in the Poincaré unit disk. And in the Poincaré unit disk, the geodesic are the circular circular paths which are orthogonal to the unit disk. So for the most simple case of Gaussian density, the distance in the sense of information geometry is given by this formula, which is the formula of the distance in the Poincaré unit disk. So this could be used for gradient descent in machine learning. So classically in machine learning, we are using this kind of gradient descent with L is a loss function, minus log the probability of Y when you know your labels on your data Y hat. But this gradient is not invariant by change of parametrization. So it's why in during the 90s, Professor Amari in Japan has introduced what we call natural gradient. So if you multiply your derivative on your loss function by the inverse of the Fisher matrices, this gradient descent will be invariant by change of parametrization. So if you change your parametrization or non-singular change of parametrization, you will not change the speed of convergence of your gradient. But the main problem was to extend that for deep learning because the vector parameter theta could be very large and it will be very difficult to estimate the Fisher matrix and to invert the Fisher matrix. But it has been done so by Yann Olivier in France and also Gaëtan Marceau in France when they work at the LRI laboratory at Paris-Saclay University. But now Yann Olivier work for Facebook AI in Paris and Gaëtan Marceau at Milan laboratory of Professor Bengio in Canada. But they have introduced an extension of the natural gradient with a stochastic term that they call the natural Langevin dynamic. So you recover the inverse of the Fisher matrix for the natural gradient, and you have an additional term given by the Langevin dynamic. So this gradient is a stochastic one, but with the property of the natural gradient to be invariant by change of parametrization. So what is important in the geometric structure of information geometry is this very simple equation. So if you are not familiar with information geometry, we define a function phi. So phi is the minus log of the Laplace transform. And if you take the Hessian of this function, you will recover the Fisher matrix. So the Fisher matrix is given by the Hessian of the minus log of the Laplace transform. And the Shannon entropy is given by the Legendre transform of this function phi. And so you have a Legendre transform between two potential functions, the entropy S and the what we call the characteristic function phi. And you have two dual systems of coordinates, nabla and theta, which are given by the first derivative of each potential function. So the Legendre transform is very simple. It plays the role of the Fourier transform for convex function. So you will consider the tangent to this curve and you will describe your convex curve by the envelope of tangents. And so when you define the tangent of one point, you can define a point here, which will give you this Legendre transformation. Okay, so I will not give the detail, but Jean-Louis Cozul has extended this relation. He has consider a more general case, so where you consider the function phi is minus log of this Laplace transform on omega. So omega is a sharp convex cone So what was the problem of Kozul? He looked for a metric which is invariant by all the automorphism of this sharp convex cone. So you have a sharp convex cone and you look for a metric which is invariant by all the automorphism of this convex cone. And so he introduced what we call the second Kozul form, which is related to the Hessian of this function phi, because the log of psi is equal to the function phi. And so it is a general relation on structure that has been given by Kozul, which is the foundation of information geometry. Okay, and so Suryo, in the chapter 4 of his book, you have the same kind of relation. So you have a function phi, which is minus log the Laplace transform. But now the Laplace transform is no longer defined on a space, Euclidean space, or on a sharp convex cone, but on M, and M is a symplectic manifold. So the relation between the symplectic manifold and the duality algebra is given by this function mu, which I will explain thereafter, which we call the moment map of Suryo. So you can define the Laplace transform on M or with this transformation, with this moment map, also on the coadjoint orbit of the coadjoint orbit, so on the duality algebra. So it's what is called in mathematics, in fact, the representation theory, where you introduce a Fourier transform on a coadjoint orbit. And then you have Legendre transform, which is preserved between S, which will be the Legendre transform of phi. And you have two systems of coordinates, but now the first variable Q is an element of the duality algebra, and beta is an element of the Lie algebra. So now you have two dual potential with phi defined by an integral on the symplectic manifold, and two system of coordinate, dual system of coordinate, but in the Lie algebra. So beta is an element of Lie algebra, and Q is an element of the dual Lie algebra. So in the Lie group thermodynamic of Suryo, beta will play the role of the Planck temperature, so the inverse of the temperature in classical thermodynamic, and Q will play the role of the heat in thermodynamic. So what is the main property of this construction is that by construction, the entropy is invariant under the action of the group. So when the Lie group acts on your system, the entropy is not altered, and so you have the invariance of the entropy under the action of the group. And also the Fischer tensor is preserved under the action of the group. So that will be very important for the next step. So what was very difficult to understand when we read for the first time the Suryo book is to understand that in fact he has introduced a metric which is given by G beta that is in fact exactly the Fischer metric. But the expression given by Suryo is very, if you are not familiar with Poisson geometry and symplectic geometry, it's not so obvious to understand. But you have, it is given by this tensor, theta tilde, where you have a first element, theta tilde, and a second term. And the second term is very well known in symplectic geometry. It is called the KKS two form. So KKS for Kirillov, Constant, and Suryo. Kirillov was a Russian mathematician, Constant an American mathematician, and Suryo. And so what is the main theorem is that when you have a Lie group, if you consider the coadjoint orbit of this Lie group, that means the action of the group on its dual Lie algebra, you can introduce a two form, which is given by this bracket, that gives a symplectic structure to the coadjoint orbit. But classically, mathematicians have studied the KKS two form, but not the case where you have an additional term, which is called the Suryo cocycle, so theta tilde. So how you could introduce this additional term? It is called in the case of non-null cohomology. So how it is introduced? G is what we call Suryo moment map. So it is a map from the symplectic manifold to the dual Lie algebra. And classically, when you have this map, you have the equality between G indexed by the Lie algebra XY and the Lie the Poisson bracket between GX and GY. And when you have not equality, you have a default of cohomology and you have an additional term, which is theta tilde. So you can find this figure in the book of Suryo. So you have a Lie group, G, and little g is an element of the Lie group G. And you are on the green you have the space of Lie algebra with beta is an element of the Lie algebra, and when the group acts, beta is transformed to adjoint with the adjoint operator, adjoint g beta, and q is indexed by beta, and when the group acts, so you have a q adjoint beta. But in fact, when the group acts on the Lie algebra, you have a dual Lie algebra, you have a coadjoint operator. But you have this relation. So classically, Q adjoint G beta should be equal to the coadjoint operator indexed by G to Q. So that it means that it is equivariant. So the coadjoint operator is equivariant. But in some case, when you have a default of cohomology, you have an additional term with the Suryo cocycle. So I will not give you the demonstration of this relation, but you could find in my paper. What I prove is that the metric that he has introduced is exactly the Hessian of the function phi. So it is purely equivalent to the Fisher metric. So you could find this other figure in the book. So on the left, you have the Lie algebra, so beta. So when the Lie group acts, you have the adjoint beta. On Q, on the right, you have the dual Lie algebra. So Q is an element of the dual Lie algebra. And when the group acts, you have the operation of the coadjoint operator, but with the additional term, which is the cocycle. But what is a very important property is that the entropy is real on the axis of real value, but is invariant under the action of the group. The function phi is not invariant. You have an additional term, but this term is linear with respect to beta. And as the Fisher metric I beta the Hessian of phi, the Fisher metric will be invariant, even if phi is not invariant. So if you want to make the connection with classical thermodynamic, you can recover the classical definition of Boltzmann-Clausius entropy. So on the top, you have the relation of Suryo. So Q is the derivative of phi with respect to beta. Beta is the derivative of S with respect to Q. And you have the Legendre transform. So entropy is the Legendre transform of phi, or phi is the Legendre transform of the entropy S. And in classical thermodynamic, beta so is the derivative of the entropy S with respect to Q. And beta in the classical thermodynamic is the Planck temperature, so the inverse of temperature. So you will recover the Clausius definition of entropy. dS is equal to dQ divided by the temperature T. What does it mean? That in fact, the classical thermodynamic is just a particular case of Suryo-Lie group thermodynamic, where you are in a Euclidean space, and the group that acts on the system is only the time translation So it is a particular case only where you have, as a Lie group, the time translation. On what Gibbs, what Suryo look for is to find a Gibbs density which is covariant under the action of the group. And this is a property of this Gibbs density, which is an exponential density, where you, so the Gibbs density will be parametrized by U, which is a moment map. So it is an element of the dual Lie algebra, and beta is an element of the Lie algebra. And you have a bracket, and it is a bracket of duality between the Lie algebra and the dual Lie algebra. But you have this property that this Gibbs density is covariant under the action of the group. So this density is not parametrized by the statistical moment. So to do that, you have to replace beta by a function which is dependent of Q that will play the role of the statistical moment. But in fact, Q is equal to derivative of phi with respect to beta. And this relation is always invertible. And so you could express beta with respect to Q, and you put in the Gibbs density, and you will have the equivalent of a Gaussian density with a property to be covariant under the action of the group. Okay, we'll skip that. Okay, so what has a main remark of Suryo? So we recover the relation. So here you have the Legendre transform, and here you have the Fisher matrix, which is given by the second derivative of the function phi, which is called z in this case. But he has remarked that the Fisher matrix plays the role of a calorific capacity in classical thermodynamics. So he gives also a thermodynamic interpretation of the Fisher matrix in information geometry. Okay, we skip that. So it is in French. So it is extracted of his paper of 1974. So here he introduced his KKS2 form, so with a classical one on the right, an additional term which is a Suryo cocycle. So you can recover that. For example, to illustrate that, he used a simple case of multivariate Gaussian density. So classically, we've write a multivariate Gaussian density like this one. So we use exponential minus one half of z minus m transpose r minus one z minus m. But in fact, this is not the good parametrization. The good parametrization on multivariate Gaussian density is not the vector m of mean m on the covariance matrix r. And so by a change of variable, you can rewrite, in fact, the multivariate Gaussian density as a Gibbs density. But for that, you need to introduce two variables, xi and beta. So xi is this structure where you have a vector z and a matrix zz transpose. And beta is also composed of a vector, minus r minus 1 m, on a matrix which is the inverse of the covariance matrix. So this parametrization is a good parametrization, which is called the natural parametrization in information geometry. And you can rewrite the multivariate Gauche density as a Gibbs density if you define the duality bracket given by this formula. So to illustrate what has been used by Suryo in physics, so in physics, in classical physics, you have this Lie group, so this matrices, which is called the Galileo group, and it is just this group define a rotation R, a boost U, and a space translation W, and a time translation E. And so you can rewrite these two relations, which are the Galileo transformation of Frenet frame, by this matricial relation, and you make appear a matrix which is called a Galileo group, and it is a Lie group. But for that, you see that you have to add an additional, you have to increase the size of your space. So you add this one here, which not play any role, but just to be able to rewrite this transformation with this matrix, which is a Lie group. So he has made some computations. So what he has observed is that for the Galileo group, you have no, you have not Gibbs equilibrium. So you have to consider one parameter subgroup of the Galileo group. So in fact, you parameterize your Lie group by one parameter, tau, indexed by the Lie algebra beta. And you you can describe one element of the Lie group by one parameter subgroup given by the real variable tau. And to illustrate that, for example, in physics by in fact the centrifuge system. So when you have a centrifuge system, in this, it is a very important this example because we understand what does it mean when it says that the temperature is an element of the Lie algebra. Because in fact, the Lie algebra in this case have two parameters, and for a centrifuge, you have two temperatures. So why you have two temperatures? Because you in fact you have two equilibrium. You have a first equilibrium, which is a classical thermodynamic equilibrium, which is given by the Planck temperature, the inverse of the temperature. But you have another equilibrium, which is the equilibrium of the angular momentum. So the wall of the centrifuge is a reservoir of angular momentum, and each particle that collide with the walls will transmit angular momentum, and with the viscosity of your liquid, it will transmit this angular momentum to all particles. So you need another temperature to describe the balance of the angular momentum. So you have two temperatures, one for the thermodynamic equilibrium and one for the angular momentum equilibrium. And when you put together these two temperatures, you could observe that this you have a structure which is an element of the Lie algebra of the group acting on this centrifuge. So you can recover the Gibbs density of a centrifuge just by applying the formula of Suryo using the group of rotation along the axis of the centrifuge. Okay, I skip that. I will skip that because I will not have time to talk about free energy. Okay. So just to give you some elements on the seminal idea of Suryo, and it's to build a covariant thermodynamic. And he has observed that the classical thermodynamic is not covariant under the action of the Galileo group. And I will not explain all the ideas in the book of Suryo, but the main idea is that in mechanics, so here you have the Newton equation in mechanics, so R is a position of the mobile. So you have m by second derivative with respect to time of air is equal to the force. But you can rewrite by m dv dt is equal to the force, and v is dr divided by dt. And if you consider the evolution space y, which is parameterized by the time t, the position r, and the speed v, you can rewrite these two equations by these two equations. So m dv minus f dt is equal to zero, and dr minus v dt is equal to zero. And if you are a geometer, these two relations build a foliation effect. And what has discovered Suryo is that you can describe mechanics by this symplectic foliation. So I will not give more detail because it could be too much complicated. That so what is important also is that in this model you have a geometric definition of entropy. So it is not in the book of Suryo and the paper of Suryo. So it's what I have observed when I have studied the equation of Suryo. So it is based on this equation. So here in this case, I call add dash. I use dash for the affine coadjoint operator. So add star is a coadjoint operator, and you have the additional Sourio cocycle. But you could observe that S add dash is equal to S. That means that, and this is a definition that the entropy is an invariant Casimir function in coadjoint representation. Why in coadjoint representation? Because Q is an element of the dual of Lie algebra, so it's an element of the coadjoint orbit. So you have this relation, and so we call a Casimir function in coadjoint representation function which are invariant on the symplectic leaves. So it has been introduced by Casimir, Henrik Casimir, which was PhD student supervised by Niels Bohr and Paul Ehrenfest in his PhD, which is a rotation of a rigid body in quantum mechanics. For a Casimir function, you have a more general definition, which is given by Poisson bracket. So the general definition of a Casimir function, so S here is a Casimir function. If the Poisson bracket between S and H is equal to zero for any H. So here I put in index theta tilde because with Sourio, we have the additional term, which is a Sourio cocycle. But so we have to modify a little the Poisson bracket to take into account the cocycle. But this Poisson bracket is could be also this equation of Casimir function could be also written in this way with this equation. So the Poisson bracket, so modified by Sourio, is this one. So the first term is very well known by the mathematician, so it's called the KKS2 form. It's given by the, it's not the KKS2 form, sorry, but it's the Poisson bracket given by this symplectic structures. And this Poisson bracket are given by the coefficient C, which are the structure coefficient in Lie group theory. So E here is the basis of the Lie algebra, and you have this relation of commutation between the element of the Lie algebra basis given by the parameter C, which are called the structure coefficient. So it means that you have real at the foundation of the structure given by the Lie group, so the Poisson bracket are given by the structure coefficient, but you have to add the second term, which is theta tilde, which is the Sourio cocycle. On this Sourio cocycle, I remember you that you can find it by the default of cohomology, which is are given by this relation where G is a Sourio moment map. So in previous slide, we see, I call also another Sourio cocycle, so we call about Sourio Sourio cocycle. So you have theta, but if you take the tangent element of theta at the neutral element, you will recover the theta tilt I have introduced. Okay. So to summarize the Sourio model, you have this equation. So you have the fact that the entropy, the Legendre transform of the characteristic function phi, that Q is an element of the dual Lie algebra, the first derivative of phi. Beta is an element of the Lie algebra, the first derivative of the entropy. The entropy is invariant under the action of the group, and it is also a Casimir function given by this classical relation in Poisson geometry, that the Poisson bracket of S and H is equal to zero. Okay. Yes, and just to remember, the function phi is minus log of the Laplace transform on the symplectic manifold. Okay. What is interesting also in this model is that you can interpret the second principle of thermodynamics, because the entropy production ds dt is proportional to the theta tilde, so the tensor introduced by Suryu, and you have this tensor is positive definite because it is linked to the Fischer tensor, and so the symmetric positive symmetric the positivity of the Fischer tensor induce a second principle of thermodynamics. On this, you could also introduce this equation, dq, the derivative of q is given by this operation, where you have the coadjoint operator but on the dual algebra. And it is the equivalent of the heat equation. You know the heat equation of Fourier, and it is a geometric version of the Fourier heat equation. And as q is the first derivative of phi, you can also write this equation on this form. And this form is also very well known by geometer because it is called Euler-Poincaré equation. So it has been introduced by Poincaré in a very famous paper in 1901. Okay, I will not give the demonstration all this relation. So to be more concrete, I will give you one example. So we will take a very simple example. And the very simple example is a Poincaré unit disk. We have seen in the motivation that it's very interesting to make machine learning in the Poincaré unit disk because, for instance, you can embed some graph. You can have a hyperbolic embedding of graph in the Poincaré unit disk. So the main problem for making machine learning in Poincaré unit disk is to define what is a Gaussian density in the Poincaré unit disk. So with the work of Suryu, we can define that. So what is a group acting on the Poincaré unit disk is a group SU11, special unitary group. Just to before giving you the example, I would like to make reference to the PhD study of Muriel Casalis, who has worked on exponential natural exponential family invariant by a group. But unfortunately, Muriel Casalis was not aware of the work of Suryu, so was not able to use the tool linked to the cohomology, the algebra cohomology developed by Suryu. But you have you can find very interesting idea in this PhD and also one of his paper, Famille exponentielle naturelle sur RD invariant par un groupe. So we will take the very simple Poincaré unit disk. So you have a Lie group. SU11, you can write it as a matrices parameterized by two variables, complex variable A and B, with the relation that the square of A minus square of B is equal to 1. So all the matrices with this structure as an element of the SU11. So you can also parameterize an element of the Lie algebra of this group by this kind of matrices with two parameters, R and Nabla. R is a real value and Nabla is a complex variable. And you can define a Lie algebra basis with this three matrices, which verify this commutation relation. So we have a Lie group, we have the Lie algebra. We need also the dual Lie algebra. So the dual Lie algebra of SU11 are given by this kind of matrices. X, Y, and Z are real value. And you can decompose each element of the dual Lie algebra on also on dual Lie algebra basis, which are given by these three matrices. Okay, so X, Y, and Z are in fact the component of the decomposition on the dual Lie algebra basis. But what we need to define what is the moment map for the SU11 Lie group. So it's not too so trivial to find it, but it is in fact this map. So to just as reminder, the moment map is a map from the symplectic manifold to the dual algebra, to the coadjoint orbit. So in the case of Poincaré unit disk, the symplectic manifold is the unit disk itself. On the dual algebra, you have this relation. So GZ is an element of the dual algebra because you can decompose it on the U1 star, U2 star, and U3 star, which are elements of the dual algebra. And you have three components, which are dependent of Z, and Z is an element of the Poincaré unit disk. What is very important also is that if you apply the formula of Souriau, the KKS2 form, so in this case, just to say you, in this case, we have not the co-cycle. In this example, for SU11, you have a null cohomology, so you have no co-cycle. So it's just an example without a Souriau co-cycle. But if you apply the KKS2 form, you will recover the metric introduced by Poincaré Poincaré unit disk. So it means that the Poincaré unit disk is also the equivalent of the metric introduced by Souriau for the KKS2 form. So just to show you by this figure, what does it mean? So Your symplectic manifold is in fact in gray. It is a Poincaré unit disk. And the coadjoint orbit are in fact the hyperbolic sheet in which are the green surfaces, which are the hyperbolic surfaces here. Why you recover this hyperbolic sheet as a coadjoint orbit? If you observe the three components here, on the dual algebra basis, so we could call this one x1, this one x2, and this one x3. You could observe that you have this relation minus x1 square minus x2 square plus x3 square is equal to r square. So in fact, you will have an hyperbolic sheet which correspond to this coadjoint orbit. So in fact, the Souriau moment map is a map from the unit disk to this hyperbolic surface. So Charles-Michel Marle has interpreted as, in fact, by stereographic projection. In fact, this transformation is an inverse stereographic projection. So from the Poincaré unit disk on the hyperbolic sheet. So this moment map on the dual algebra basis, obviously you can rewrite as a matrix element of the dual algebra. So you can rewrite this map on this way. So you have four components here, where Z is an element of the unit disk. But you can recover that this matrices as the structure of an element of the dual algebra. You have opposite value on the diagonal, and you have also the minus conjugate value on the entête diagonal, and it's what you recover here. You have the opposite value here, and here you have minus the conjugate value on the trans diagonal. So this matrix is an element of the dual algebra. And so, what is the Gibbs density for Souriau? It is given by this formula. So, it is a duality bracket between the moment map indexed by Z, an element of the point in the Poincaré unit disk, and beta. On beta, you can write it as a matrices, which is an element of the Lie algebra. And so these matrices, this density of Gibbs will be covariant under the action of the group SU11. And to recover a Gauss density, you have to replace this term, which is the geometric Planck temperature, an element of the Lie algebra, by inverting the relation between Q and beta. So the objective is to index by Q. And you could observe that this density is parametrized by an element of the Lie algebra. And in this element of the Lie algebra, you have two terms, R and nabla. And so these two terms will play the role of the centrality for the Gaussian density and the variance for the Gaussian density. Okay, and also to make the link to another geometric interpretation. So for example, here this is the expression of the Poisson bracket for the SU11 Lie group for the Poincaré unit disk. So you can rewrite in coordinate like this with this transformation, the Poisson bracket. So it is I've write this this figure, which is very important to understand the new definition of entropy and the new geometric definition of Lie group thermodynamic. So you, in fact, sorry, you have a unit disk, and you observe that you have the coadjoint orbit at the symplectic leaves. So symplectic leaves, because in mathematics we call that a foliation, a symplectic foliation. So you can define different leaves, which are this hyperbolic sheet. So this symplectic leaf, this hyperbolic surface, are in fact the level set of entropy. Okay. So what says the theory of Souriau? Said that the entropy are defined on this symplectic leaves, and the entropy is a Casimir function. That it means that the entropy is invariant along this symplectic leaves. So what does it mean? If your dynamic is described on this symplectic leaves, it means that the entropy is constant. So it means that you are describing a non-dissipative phenomena. On the opposite, if you have a dynamic which is described transversely to the symplectic leaves, you will move from one symplectic leaf to another. And in fact, the symplectic leaves are the level set of the entropy, because the entropy is constant on each leaf. And so you will have an increase of the entropy. And what is that? Is the second principle of thermodynamics. Okay, so just to summarize that, when you are describing a non-dissipative phenomena, you are along the symplectic leaves, the hyperbolic sheet is here. And when you have a dynamic which is transverse to this structures, and from leaf to leaf, from level set to level set of entropy, you have a dissipative phenomena, because you will describe an increase of entropy. And so the second term is introduced by another bracket, which is called a metric flow bracket. And it's just to I will introduce you more in detail this dynamic hereafter, which is called a metriplectic flow. I just want to extend my example to a more complex one. I will no longer consider the Poincaré unit disk, but I will consider the Ziegle disk. So if you are not familiar with the Ziegle disk, I will explain you what is it. And you have another Lie group acting on the Ziegle disk. It is called the SUNN Lie group. And we will see that as a particular case, in this case, we can recover the Gaussian density for symmetric positive definite matrices. So first, I have to introduce the Ziegle space. So if you are familiar with Poincaré, so the upper half plane of Poincaré is x is a real and y is positive. Here, what we call the Ziegle upper half space is the same thing, but with a matrix extension. So z is x plus ey. X and y are symmetric matrices, but y is symmetric and positive definite. Okay, so it plays the same role than upper half plane of Poincaré, but with matrices. So I will not give here the details. So just to make you a figure, so I use a figure of Poincaré upper half plane, but in fact, with this in the Ziegler upper half plane, you can find some formula to compute the distance between two points in this space. And especially, you can find the formula if you restrict yourself to the pure imaginary axis. The pure imaginary axis describes the symmetric matrices which are positive definite. So it is a space of symmetric positive definite matrices. So the main idea is to say that, okay, we are looking now for the Gibbs density, which is invariant under the action of the group acting on this space. And when we will restrict ourselves to the pure imaginary axis, we will recover what is the Gibbs density for symmetric positive definite matrices. So it's just to make the relation between Poincaré upper half plane and Ziegler upper half plane and Poincaré unit disk and Ziegler unit disk. So here you have on the left, you have Poincaré upper half plane on the left on the top, where you have the metric of Poincaré that you could rewrite y minus 1 dz y minus 1 dz star with z is x plus ey. But for Ziegler upper half plane, you have the same formula, but with matrices. So the ds square is just the trace of the inverse of the matrix Y, dz, the inverse of the matrix Y, dz bar. And you can define, as previously, you can define with the Kellett transform z minus I divided by z plus I, the Poincaré unit disk. You can also define the Ziegler unit disk by the same transformation when you replace Z by matrices. So you know it is Z minus E time identity by the inverse of the matrix Z plus E identity. So the main idea is to compute the Sourio moment map. So it is given by this formula. So if you remember the moment map for the SU11, it is exactly the same formula, but we have replaced Z, which was previously in the Poincaré unit disk, by a matrix Z, which is an element in the Ziegler unit disk. And so by the Sourio formula, you can define the Gibbs density, which is in covariant under the action of the group SU and N. And if you restrict yourself to the case where you will consider X is equal to zero and you consider only the matrix Y, so when Z is only EY, when Z is given by this, because you are now in the Ziegler disk, so Y is a symmetric positive definite matrices, and Z is parameterized by Y by this relation. And you put that in this density, and you will have the Gibbs density for the symmetric positive definite matrices. To conclude, I will just introduce the symplectic foliation model that I've introduced for the Poincaré unit disk. So it is introduced by what we call metriplectic model, which has been introduced by Morrison, for example, in US for physics of plasma. So you have an evolution equation, which is given by two terms. The first one is a Poisson bracket, and the second one is a metric flow bracket. And in fact, the property of this metric flow, metriplectic flow, you should use the fact that the entropy is a Casimir function of the Poisson bracket. And the energy, H, is a Casimir function for the metric flow bracket. So you need that to preserve the first principle of thermodynamic, preservation of energy, and the second principle of thermodynamics, which is entropy production. So if you consider the metriplectic flow, df dt is equal to the Poisson bracket FF plus the metric flow bracket F, big F, where F is the sum of the energy and the entropy. You should have also the fact that the metric flow bracket should be symmetric and positive definite. So why we need this constraint? Because you have the first principle of thermodynamics, so energy conservation. So H is in the energy. So if you apply that in the metric flow evolution equation, you have two terms. So the small f has been replaced by H. And so if you decompose, F is equal to H plus S. And so this term is equal to zero by symmetry, the Poisson bracket between H and H. The Poisson bracket between F and S should be equal to zero. That it means that S, the entropy, is a Casimir function for this Poisson bracket. And you need also to cancel this term that the metric flow bracket between H and F is equal to zero. That it means that H is a Casimir function for the metric flow bracket. And for the second principle of thermodynamics, if you compute the metric flow for S, in fact, you will have this equation, and you will find that this term is equal to zero because S is a Casimir function of the Poisson bracket, and this term is equal to zero because H is a Casimir function of the metric flow bracket. So you have only one term, which is the metric flow bracket between S and S. And as this metric flow bracket is positive definite, you have the fact that the production of entropy is positive. So it is the second principle of thermodynamics. So this equation describes jointly with the Poisson bracket the non-dissipative dynamic, and with the metric flow bracket, the dissipative dynamic. But when the people have introduced metriplectic model, they have imposed that the entropy should be a Casimir function associated to the Poisson bracket. But with the Souriau model, first, by construction, the entropy is a Casimir function. And secondly, with the foliation, symplectic foliation, we can geometrically interpret the two terms in this metriplectic flow. So the Poisson bracket describes the dynamic on the symplectic leaves, and the metric flow bracket describes the dynamic transverse to the symplectic leaves. To move from symplectic leaf to symplectic leaf, so to symplectic leaf are the level set of entropy. So you move from level set to level set of entropy, and you have entropy production. Okay, I will not give more detail on this metriplectic flow, but we are working on this model just to give a geometric interpretation of the metriplectic flow, but I will not have time to give more detail. Just to say that Baptiste Coquinot at École Normale Supérieure de Paris has proved that the metriplectic flow is a good model, in fact, because he has link the metriplectic flow with what we call the Onzinger Casimir relation describing the non-equilibrium thermodynamic. So I will not give the detail, but in fact, Baptiste Coquinot has proved that the metriplectic flow is compliant with the Onzinger relation of non-equilibrium thermodynamic. So it proves that the metric flow is a good model of non-equilibrium thermodynamic and dissipative phenomena. Coquinot says that our construction above shows that the dissipative brackets are completely natural for non-equilibrium thermodynamics, just as Poisson brackets are natural for Hamiltonian thermodynamic. Okay. So I will skip that also because what we have exploring is that in fact the transverse structure of the symplectic leaves has been studied by mathematicians, on especially by Hervé Sabourin, which describe in fact these transverse structures that we call transverse Poisson structure, and so it has give a very rigorous definition of this transverse structure, but I will not have time to describe in this case. Okay. So just to make the relation, so it is my examples with the Poincaré unit disk. So the Poisson bracket will describe the dynamic on the symplectic leaves. On the metric flow bracket, we describe the transverse dynamic to the symplectic leaves, describing a dissipative phenomena with the increase of entropy. What we assume, but we have not yet proved, is that in fact this metric flow bracket is linked to the Fischer metric. So it is a metric flow bracket, and the metric should be considered is a Fischer metric for describing this dynamic. So I will not give you more detail on what kind of application, so because it is not in the domain of machine learning, but we have applied that for Lindblad equation. So Lindblad equation is a Liouville equation with a non-dissipative term. So it is used to stabilize qubit. So I will give you the equation of the this kind of equation. So it is called the Lindblad equation. So you have a term, non-dissipative term. So in fact, you have the Liouville equation, the evolution of the density for in quantum physics, density of a quantum state. But you have an additional term, which is a dissipative term, which is linked also to a metriplectic flow. And especially, Oettinger has introduced this flow as a metriplectic flow. But I will have no time to detail. So what to remember after forgetting everything. So first, that this model of geometric mechanics developed by Jean-Marie Storio as part of mechanical statistics allows us to define an invariant Fischer metric on covariant statistical density for Lie group. So with the model of Storio, you can define what is a Gaussian density on a Lie group or Gaussian density in a homogeneous space. You can define a Gaussian density in the Poincaré unit disk, or you can define a Gaussian density for the group SU11, because each point in the Poincaré unit disk could be described as an element of the SU11 Lie group. But you have also an invariant, you can define also an invariant Fischer metric. So it means that you have a metric space. So it's also very useful for machine learning, because with a Fischer metric, you can develop some algorithms which are based on unsupervised machine learning. And with density of probability, covariant density of probability, you can develop a statistical machine supervised machine learning. So the Storio model makes it possible to define Lie group statistics on machine learning because you have a Gibbs density of maximum entropy that will give the role of the Gauss density for Lie group or for homogeneous symplectic manifold. And also, all this model are parameterized by the Storio moment map, which is a fundamental tool in this model. And this tool is very fundamental also in physics because it is a geometrization of the Noether theorem. But what is also very interesting is that this model provides us a new definition of entropy, purely geometric, because the entropy is an invariant Casimir function in coadjoint representation. So it means that if you have a group, a Lie group, You have an equation describing a Casimir function associated to this Lie group. So it means that you can construct the entropy function from the symmetry and from the Lie group. Contrary to the classical theory of information, where the entropy is given by axiomatic definition, as Shannon did. Just to conclude, if you are interested by this model, it's very difficult to read the book of Suryo. So you have an English translation, but Suryo uses his own notation, which are not the classical one in Lie group theory. So I invite you to read the book of Paulette Lieberman and Charles Michel Mauer, Symplectic Geometry and Analytical Mechanics, because all the tools of Suryo are described, and especially the cocycle, when the coadjoint operator is not equivariant and you have this cocycle, it is described in this book. So you have a more recent book by Charles Michel Mauer, Geometrie Symplectique et Géométrie de Poisson, but fortunately, it has not been yet translated in English. And obviously, you have also the book that we have supervised the translation in English, the book of Kozul, Introduction to Symplectic Geometry, where you have in modern notation the model of Suryo with a moment map with a Suryo cocycle. And for Poisson geometry, you have also very good book by Yvette Kosman-Schwarzbach and also by Camille Laurent-Djengou, which is called Poisson Structures. And also you have a book by Géry de Saxey and Claude Vallée, Galilean Mechanics and Thermodynamics of Continua, which are also developing the Suryo tools. And this is my conclusion. So thank you for your attention.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you. Any questions?
Hello. I actually have a question.
Yeah.
Right. So actually what I'm doing is learning a Hamiltonian system. And I see this is very fruitful literature for all this new definition of entropy and new environment metric and whatever. But I'm just curious, can you make it more specific or clearer how this metric or this new definition of entropy can be used for constructing machine learning algorithms? Because there should be something like structure preserving that could become out of all this theorem, right? So can you elaborate on that?
Yes, so the idea is that I have to share my screen. Okay. So if you come back to the gradient descent, yes. Okay. Yeah. So
next slide maybe.
Yes, this is a classical gradient descent in machine learning. Yeah. So you have you use the loss function.
Mm-hmm.
So in information geometry, classical information geometry, we are using this natural gradient. So to extend that, so in the Suryo model, theta will be an element of the Lie algebra. Because in fact, you are parameterized in the Lie algebra, and so you need this Fisher matrix will be given I, the Fisher tensor will be given by the expression of Suryo. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So in fact, you theta will be an element of the Lie algebra. And the Fisher tensor will be given by the formula of Suryo for this tensor. So what I call theta tilde beta, which is the general formula for this parameter.
So it's like a geometric equivalent notion of Fisher information there, right?
Yes, yes, it is a pure generalization of because in the definition, so this formula seems very complex. So in symplectic geometry, it is called the KKS2 form, but with a cocycle, so it's more complex. It's a KKS2 form on the right term, on a cocycle with the term on the left. And this tensor is exactly the Fischer tensor. So why it is exactly the Fischer tensor? Because you can prove that this term is exactly the Hessian of the function phi. And the function phi is the minus log of the Laplace transform on the symplectic manifold. So we preserve between the model of information geometry. So here you have the model of information geometry. Mm-hmm. Phi is the minus log of the Laplace transform. And the Fischer metric is the Hessian of this function. And you have the Legendre transform. So the entropy is the Legendre transform of this function.
Mm-hmm.
In the Fourier model. Like,
So it's like a generalization from Euclidean space to symplectic manifold. Can I understand like that?
Yes, yes, yes. So now your parameter space are elements in the Lie algebra and dual Lie algebra. So beta mm-hmm. is in the Lie algebra, Q is in the dual Lie algebra. And your Laplace transform is defined on a symplectic manifold M. But you could also define this integral on the dual Lie algebra, because in fact, you can use the moment map U here, which is a map from the symplectic manifold M to the dual Lie algebra.
Mm-hmm.
And in mathematics, in representation theory, you have many literature on what is how to extend the Fourier transform for Lie group. And you have to define this Laplace transform on the coadjoint orbit. So it's all the theory is related to coadjoint orbit. So the keyword is coadjoint orbit. So the action of the group on the dual Lie algebra. Yes, I skip one very important result of Souriau. I think I skip it. It is a theorem of Souriau. Yes. Yes. What is the main theorem of Souriau? This one. So what we call a coadjoint orbit is this set, subset of dual Lie algebra. So G is an element of the group. So the action of the group on F, which is an element of the dual Lie algebra. And so the subset is called coadjoint orbit. Okay. Mm-hmm. And the theorem of Souriau is that if you have an element of a group, if you consider its coadjoint orbit to all coadjoint orbit, you can associate two forms. Which is called the KKS2 form. And this KKS2 form give a symplectic structure to the coadjoint orbit.
Mm-hmm.
So if you remember the example of Poincaré unit disk, the group is SU11. The coadjoint orbit are the hyperbolic sheet, the hyperbolic leaves. So they are the symplectic leaves. And to this symplectic leaves, you can associate a KKS2 form that gives you a metric to this symplectic manifold. And so your coadjoint orbit could be considered as symplectic manifold. Mm-hmm. So this is the main theorem of Souriau. But in this case, I don't put the cocycle, but the theorem Souriau is given also with the cocycle. But classically, mathematicians they don't consider the affine case of Souriau, so they don't consider the cocycle. They say that Souriau has considered the affine case, but many mathematicians were not interested. But for our application in machine learning, it's very important. By all the group we are manipulating are very often they have a non-null cohomology, so you have this co-cycle. For example, SO3, you have this co-cycle. SO3, you have not the co-cycle, group of rotation, but SO3, rotation translation, you have this co-cycle. The Galileo group, you have this co-cycle. For affine group, general affine group, you have the problem of co-cycle. So the formula of Sourio are very general. So what is the idea is that you can generalize the information geometry. Mm-hmm. And you can generalize the structure of gradient descent for Lie group because you can extend the notion of Fisher tensor, you can extend the notion of Fisher metric, you can define a geometric structure to each element. You preserve what is very important. Alors, I have no time to explain, but to yes, I could. Yes, I have skipped that, but many people use the notion of free energy, which is mm-hmm. this formula. And this relation is not good. This is not a good potential. Why? Because you don't preserve the Legendre transform. What should mm-hmm. you should use is Massieu potential. So we have to divide the free energy by the temperature. In this case, you can rewrite like that. So F divided by T, so you call this function phi, is the inverse of temperature by the energy. So the inverse of temperature is beta. So you can rewrite that bracket beta E minus the entropy. And in this case, this potential is the Legendre transform of the entropy. This is not the true for the free energy. Here you have not the Legendre transform. And if you don't preserve the Legendre transform, you are not able to extend the information geometry because all the information geometry are based on this Legendre transform. So, so you have to preserve the Legendre transform. The entropy should be the Legendre transform of the phi, which is the minus log of the Laplace transform. In statistics, minus log of Laplace transform is a moment generating function, the cumulant generating function.
Mm-hmm. I see. Maybe another very quick question. So I also wonder the application of this Lie group invariance of this entropy. So how is that important implication? Is that you embed your symmetry inside your machine?
No. What is important is when you want to extend the notion of Gaussian density. Okay. Mm-hmm. What is a Gaussian density? The Gaussian density is a density of maximum entropy. Mm-hmm. If you look for a density that maximizes the entropy, minus log P, under the constraint that you know the first moment, you know the variances, and you know that your density should be normalized, you will recover the classical Gaussian density. So the good definition of a Gaussian density is a mm-hmm. density of maximum entropy. So yes. If you want to extend this notion of Gaussian density to more abstract space, and especially for Lie group, you have mm-hmm. to generalize the notion of entropy. So yes. You have to define what is the generalized entropy, and then you will define the density of maximum entropy.
I see. And the symmetry of the Lie group is necessary for such a construction because it's
called. It's not necessary. It's when you generalize by this way, mm-hmm. it is a property. It's by design, the mm-hmm. entropy is a Casimir function. Okay, so this property was hidden in classical Shannon entropy. Because when you work on R, on the Euclidean space, you don't see any symmetry, in fact. But when you generalize, this property is the very natural. Is by construction, your entropy should be a Casimir function.
I see.
And, so but it changes the definition of entropy because in Shannon, Shannon introduced entropy by an axiomatization. He gives some axiom that the entropy should follow. And mm-hmm. then he gives that the Shannon entropy is a good, the good entropy that follows this axiom. Here is different. The Shannon entropy is defined as a Casimir function in coadjoint representation. So if you, you can take the group, take the equation of the, yes, I could show you that. There is many literature of Russian mathematician on that. Just to say how to construct the entropy. Yes. So it's if you take the equation on the right, when you say that S, the entropy is a Casimir function, you should verify that the Poisson bracket should be equal to zero. But here you have an additional term due to the co-cycle. But so your entropy should be solution of this equation. And then you can build the entropy from this equation. And this equation is given by the Lie group structure because the Poisson bracket, the first term is given, the Poisson bracket is given by the coefficient C, and the coefficient C are the structure coefficient of your Lie group. Okay. And E is the basis of your Lie group. You have a commutation relation for the Lie algebra basis, and they are given by the structure coefficient. So this Poisson bracket will be given by the structure coefficient, so will be given by the your Lie algebra of your Lie group. And the second term also could be computed by the moment map, so it's also a pure geometric term that you can compute. If you take the example of the Poincaré unit disk, what are the structure coefficients? I didn't insist on that, but here you have the commutation relation of the Lie algebra basis. So you could observe that the first structure coefficient is 1, 1, and minus 1. Okay. And so you can define the Poisson bracket. You can compute the coefficient of the Poisson bracket, which are given by the structure coefficient. So it's a very new foundation of theory of information on what is the important concept in geometry and the concept of foliation. Here in this example, you see that the symplectic leaves define a foliation, a symplectic foliation. So it is a different hyperbolic sheet here. This hyperbolic sheet are the level set of entropy. And why they are the level set of entropy? Because the entropies are constant along the symplectic leaves, the hyperbolic sheet. Because the entropy is a Casimir function. So it describes geometrically the information theory and geometrically the thermodynamic. And so mathematician has worked a lot. It's why for the time being we are working on is to use, I'm reading a lot the literature on geometric foliation. So symplectic foliation, Riemannian foliation, because also you see that the transverse structures is linked to a Riemannian, what we call a Riemannian foliation, which is linked to the Fischer metric. So so the literature in mathematics of foliation is very rich because it has been introduced by Rieb and Ereshman, the notion of foliation, and then developed a lot by many mathematicians on symplectic foliation, Riemannian foliation, and So all these very natural tools in geometry could be used and give a geometric, pure geometric interpretation of the information geometry, of the thermodynamic, and also of the geometry of learning.
I see. Thanks so much for this explanation again.
So it's not so obvious, because if you are people who are not familiar with Lie theory, Lie group theory, with also coadjoint orbit, the very important notion is the notion of coadjoint orbit. So coadjoint orbit was studied a lot. So mathematicians at the beginning of at the mid of last century. With Kirillov in Russia, with Michel Vergne in France, Duflo also in France, Dixmier also in France, is how to extend analysis on Lie group. What is the extension of Fourier transform on Lie group? So you have to introduce this notion of integral on coadjoint orbit. And it is what is called the representation theory of Lie group, which has been introduced by in France by Kirillov, in Russia by Kirillov, in France by Duflo, Vergne, Souriau, and in US by Costant.
Yeah, because it's the first time I see this combined with information geometry and entropy, because typically what we consider is just trajectories, then you predict the trajectory, but see, we didn't.
Yes, but trajectory means that you need an unbounding space. Here, all is fully intrinsic. The notion is to avoid to define what is the notion of projection. If you talk about projection, it means that you have an unbounding space. Here we talk about foliation, because when you try to define what is the shortest path in the transverse structures, you have to define this metric space in the transverse structure of the foliation. So it's really to rewrite fully intrinsically the geometric structure of the information geometry and the geometry of learning.
Mm-hmm. I see. Thanks so much for the answer.
Thank you. Any other questions? Maybe a quick question regarding geometric deep learning of Bornstein. And so how would this work differ?
No, Bornstein is different. It's what I call I work also on this topic. So what we call geometric deep learning or equivariant neural network is another topic where you need the Lie group, but it's not the same. I will show you the difference. So it was I give that in my introduction, but I talk too much. Yes. In fact, the Lie group in machine learning appears in two approaches. So today I talk about Lie group machine learning, where you try to make statistics on machine learning on Lie group. So your data are an element of Lie group, or you work on data which are in a homogeneous space. So your data could be represented by an element of Lie group. In Max Whelling work or Michael Bornstein work, the Lie group are considering differently. You try to find a neural network which is equivariant to some geometric transformation. Okay, so you apply classical deep machine learning on images, but you would like that your classifier could have the property of equivariance to the rotation and to the translation of your images. Okay, so in this case, you have the group SE2 for rotation and translation. And for that, you will define convolution on Lie group to have a neural network which is by design have this property of equivariance. So by design, your performance of classification will not be altered if your images are have submit rotation and translation. So you could say yes, but you could use augmented technique, and so take your data set, apply the geometric transformation, and learn on this data. But in this case, you will augment a lot your data set. So you need a larger neural network. And it has been proved that geometric deep learning and so equivariant neural network are more robust than augmented technique. So it is I work on this topic with one colleague, which is Pierre-Yves Lagrave. We have applied this technique for data in the Poincaré unit disk, because Michael Bronstein and Max Wellings, they have used what we call a compact group, but SU11 is a non-compact group, and so numerical schemes are more complex. And we apply that also for when you have a fisheye camera. You know what is a fisheye camera? Is an hemispheric camera. The idea is that you can project the half sphere on the unit disk, and then try to define an equivariant neural network which is equivariant to the SU11 Lie group. And the idea is that if you want to recognize an object in a fisheye camera, it will submit some very strong deformation according to the place in the light of sight of the fisheye camera. And so is to develop equivalent neural network for fisheye camera. And for that, we need to extend Michael Bronstein and Max Welling work for non-compact group by projecting the half sphere on the unit disk. Unfortunately, I didn't include some slide on this topic, but you can see in my publication with Pierre-Yves Lagrave, we have some publication on how to extend geometric deep learning for non-compact group. So for example, geometric deep learning in the Poincaré unit disk. So we apply that also for radar data, which are by design defined in the Poincaré unit disk.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Any so, but questions? In the conference I have organized in GSI, we are dealing with so in GSI conference you have the different communities. So in GSI 2021 at Sorbonne University, we have invited Max Welling and also Eric Baker, which is also work on this topic in Netherlands, has a session on equivariant neural network. So in GSI conference, Geometric Science of Information, we are mixing the different communities using Lie group for equivariant neural network or for machine learning on Lie group.
Yeah, I think it's nice to contrast one from the other, just to see how they relate to each other. Yeah.
Yes, they are using Lie group, but it's a different approach.
A different approach. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Any other questions or comments? Yeah, maybe like last question. I don't know if like a practical question about like learning. I'm also like working on learning Hamiltonian dynamics. So one question that is common is that, how would you decide whether, given data, would you be, how to decide whether it's coming from Hamiltonian dynamical system or not?
Yes. I know, for example, in Imperial College in UK, you have also some people working on more on geometric mechanics. But now there is some. I have invited some people from Imperial College also in Leouche, l'école des Houches, where they have also presented the Hamiltonian dynamics. So there is also close connection with this community. I have no time to discuss this point, but what is also very famous in symplectic geometry is symplectic integrators. And symplectic integrators are more robust than classical integrators. Why? Because you can define Euler Poincaré equation preserving the Casimir function and preserving the moment map. And why is important in physics to preserve the moment map? because the moment map is a geometrization of Noether theorem. So if you preserve the moment map, you will preserve the invariant of your problem. And sometimes in physics, you have the preservation of the entropy. You can have the preservation of the angular momentum. And classically, in partial differential equation with classical integrator, you don't preserve this invariant. And so it's with this geometric approach, you can define some geometric integrators, and especially symplectic integrators, which by design has this property to preserve the moment map, the Casimir function, and they are very efficient for also optimization and machine learning.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? Okay, yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, and hopefully we'll get a chance to meet again. Yeah, thank you.
Okay,
yeah, thanks a lot. Thank you. Thanks everyone. Thanks, bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.